Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magnus Nordahl and I am an airline captain and instructor. Many people are curious about the path to becoming an airline pilot. To earn a commercial license in multi-engine and instrument ratings, along with a frozen ATPL, which means you have passed the theoretical ATPL exams, you will need a specific set of skills and mindset, and lots of money. Some airlines may also prefer or require educational backgrounds in physics and mathematics. But is a STEM degree really necessary? Not really. Most of the heavy engineering is handled by specialists. That said, having a logical and analytical mindset definitely helps. If you can divide 12 by 3 without reaching for a calculator, and if you understand that the aerodynamic force on a wing splits into lift and drag vectors, you are already grasping some of the core mathematical concepts pilots use. Logical thinking and a solid grasp of the basics go a long way in aviation. 1. In the aviation world, a standard descent gradient is typically 3 degrees. This angle is also common for most instrument approach procedures. For this, a simple rule of thumb emerges for calculating your top of descent, TOD. To determine your TOD in nautical miles from the runway threshold, multiply your cruising altitude in thousands of feet above the destination airport by 3. For example, if you're cruising at 18,000 feet above the airport, you should begin your descent 54 track miles from the runway. 2. When flying a 3-degree descent, there's a useful rule of thumb for estimating your required rate of descent. Simply multiply your ground speed in knots by 5. For example, if your ground speed is 140 knots, your target descent rate should be approximately 700 feet per minute. While the exact value is slightly higher, as indicated on approach charts, this quick calculation is accurate enough for practical use during most approaches. 3. Understanding how ground speed translates into distance travel over time is essential for situation awareness. Here is a simple reference. At 60 knots ground speed, you travel 1 nautical mile per minute. At 120 knots, it's 2 nautical miles per minute. At 300 knots, you're traveling 5 nautical miles per minute. When flying under visual flight rules, VFR, minimum flight visibility requirements vary based on altitude and airspace classification. These minimums range from 1.5 kilometers to 8 kilometers. So what does that mean in practical terms? If your ground speed is 100 knots, you're covering about 3 kilometers per minute. To estimate this in metric units, use the formula ground speed in kilometers per hour divided by 60 equals distance traveled per minute in kilometers. For example, 100 knots is 185 kilometers per hour. 185 divided by 60 gives 3 kilometers per minute. This helps put visibility requirements into perspective. You should always be able to see far enough ahead to react in time based on how fast you're moving. 4. Hopefully, you will never need this rule, but it's good to know. If the engines fail, how far can you glide? Can you reach a nearby airport for a dead stick landing? To estimate glide distance from altitude, use this rule of thumb. 6,000 feet of altitude equals 1 nautical mile vertically. From there, apply the aircraft's glide ratio. For the ATR-72, the lift-to-drag ratio is 15.8 to 1. But using a conservative estimate of 15 to 1 is practical. That means for every 1 nautical mile or 6,000 feet of altitude, you can glide 15 nautical miles forward. For example, 18,000 feet divided by 6,000 equals 3 nautical mile altitude. 3 nautical miles multiplied by 15 equals 45 nautical mile of glide distance. Keep in mind, wind matters. Tailwind increases your range, headwind reduces it. Weight doesn't affect glide distance, but it does influence your optimum glide speed. For ATIA aircraft, the best glide speed is Whiteberg plus 10 knots with flaps retracted in normal atmospheric conditions. In icing conditions, glide performance worsens due to increased drag and higher minimum speed. Icing bug. 5. Need a quick estimate for how much fuel you need from point A to point B? Here's a simple planning method for the ATIA 72. First hour, 800 kilo of fuel. Each additional hour, 700 kilo per hour. For example, if you have 2,400 kilos fuel on board, after 1 hour, you have 1,600 kilo remaining. After 2 hours, you have 900 kilos remaining. And after 3 hours, you have 200 kilos remaining. Time to be on the ground. This method is intentionally conservative. In most operational conditions, actual fuel burn is typically lower. For holding patterns, plan on 600 kilos per hour or 10 kilos per minute. 6. Jet fuel density varies with temperature. In tropical climate, it's typically around 0.785 kilos per liter, while in colder conditions, it's closer to 0.80 kilos per liter. This colder climate density is convenient for quick mental math. 1 kilo is 1.25 liters, 1 kilo is 2.2 pounds, and 1 pound is 0.45 kilos, or half the value in kilos minus a tenth. Before flying the ATR, I flew the Jetstream 31. The challenge? Different units everywhere. Fuel indicators show pounds. The load sheet used kilograms, and the fuel truck delivered liters. Here's a typical scenario. I had 430 pounds of fuel in the left tank and 450 pounds in the right. 880 pounds total, which equals approximately 400 kilos. For the next flight, I needed 760 kilos. So 760 kilos minus 400 kilos is 360 kilos needed to top up. To convert to liters, 360 kilos multiplied by 1.25 is 360 plus a quarter of 360, 90, giving a total of 450 liters. To balance the load, I would order 230 liters in the left tank and 220 liters in the right tank. This kind of manual conversion was important, so I always used pen and paper. In over 10 years as captain on the Jetstream, I only got it wrong once and had to call the fuel truck back. Flying the ATR simplifies things. The refueling system is automatic, and all you need to do is to specify the total fuel quantity you required in the tanks before engine start. No conversions, no guesswork, just efficiency. 7. Let's say you're preparing to depart from or land on runway 12 and the wind is reported at 180 degrees at 25 knots. What is the crosswind component? You could refer to a crosswind chart, but there's a handy mental shortcut. The angle between the wind direction and runway heading determines the crosswind component. 0 degrees difference means 0% of wind speed is crosswind. 30 degrees off means 50% of wind speed. 45 degrees off means 70% of wind speed. 60 degrees off means 90% of wind speed. And 90 degrees off means 100% of full crosswind. These values are easy to remember and apply quickly in flight. So, in our example, is runway 12 aligned 220 degrees. The wind is from 180 degrees, so the angle difference is 60 degrees. 25 knots multiplied by 0.9 is 23 knots crosswind component. What about headwind or tailwind component? Just reverse the logic. At 0 degree angle, you get 100% headwind or tailwind. At 60 degrees off, only 50% of the wind contributes as headwind or tailwind. 8. A meter provides a wealth of information for pilots, and one often overlooked detail is the dew point. The dew point is the temperature at which air becomes saturated with water vapor, meaning it can no longer hold moisture in gas form. When air cools to this point, condensation occurs, forming dew, fog, or clouds. The difference between the air temperature and the dew point is known as the dew point depression or dew point spread. This value gives a quick indication of humidity. A small spread means humid air. A large spread indicates dry air. As a rule of thumb, when humidity is 50%, the dew point spread is roughly 10 degrees Celsius. As a glider pilot, I learned a useful method for estimating the base of cumulus clouds using this formula. Dew point spread per degree Celsius is 125 meters or 400 feet. For example, if the spread is 5 degrees Celsius, cloud bases are typically around 2000 feet above ground level. Since temperatures in meters are rounded to the nearest whole degree, allow for a margin of plus minus 200 feet. At some airports, especially those without a ceilometer and with no nearby terrain, estimating the actual cloud base can be tricky. I experienced this while flying in Nigeria, where one tower controller routinely reported the cloud base as 1000 feet, regardless of actual conditions. So I began relying on dew point spread instead. For instance, when the temperature was 32 degrees Celsius and the dew point 22 degrees Celsius, the spread was 10 degrees, meaning we could expect to be clear of clouds at around 4000 feet. A 1 degree spread often meant we might not break out at ILS minima. On one particular flight, that's exactly what happened. The spread was 1 degree Celsius and the reported ceiling was 1000 feet as usual. At minima, we didn't acquire the required visual references and had to go around. On the second approach, they remembered to put on the approach lights. The ceiling had lifted slightly and we landed safely. That landing is coming up in a minute. Finally, after the last landing of the day, the hardest task remains, summing up the aircraft's technical log. It's straightforward, just don't forget that 1 hour equals 60 minutes. Simple but easy to overlook when you're tired. And that's about it. If you have any other practical rules of thumb that fellow aviators might find useful, feel free to share them in the comments below. As always, a big thank you to the channel supporters. They get early access to all videos, 2 days before everyone else. Thank you for watching, have a wonderful day, and happy learning!